everybody, and welcome back to another Wheel of Time video. So just a week or so ago, another major fantasy book adaptation dropped on Netflix with the television adaptation of Andrzej Sapkowski's Witcher series. There have been mixed reviews from critics about the series, and while this is a Wheel of Time channel, I wanted to not only give you my opinions of the Witcher series in general, but also relate it back to the Wheel of Time and let you know what I think the Wheel of Time can learn from the Witcher television adaptation. Now, real quick, I want to let you guys know to stay tuned to the very end of the video, as I will be giving you a sneak peek of the Wheel of Time community website that we've been creating, and I'll let you know the name of the website as well, so definitely stay tuned. But let's go ahead and hop into my review of The Witcher and what the Wheel of Time can learn from the Witcher series. Now, this video will carry a spoiler rating of green, with no spoilers for either the Wheel of Time or The Witcher. This will be a spoiler-free review of The Witcher, as far as I can, but I may talk about some names and themes in the show, but no plot details. Feel free to watch this video if you haven't read The Wheel of Time or The Witcher. So given this is my first review on the channel, I want to lay out how I'm going to structure this. So all of you guys know I can't possibly do anything without creating some sort of stupid rating system to sort out my feelings. And so, of course, that's what I did here. I've broken down my review into 10 different categories that I think encompass what makes a television show great. Those categories are as follows: acting, writing, pacing, tone and feel of the show, cinematography, fight choreography, set design, costume and makeup, special effects, and music. Each of the categories will get a score out of 10 with a total score out of 100, and then I'm going to divide that by 10 and give kind of a score out of 10. Once I review The Witcher, then I'll give you what I think the Wheel of Time can learn from the show and what I think will be the same and what I think will be different. So let me start by giving you the backstory of The Witcher. The television show is again based on the popular book and video game series that was written by Andrzej Sapkowski, starting as a collection of short stories back in 1990 and evolving into multiple other short stories, novels, and video games. The most popular of those games, The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, is widely considered one of the best games of all time. The Witcher follows the exploits of Geralt of Rivia, a Witcher that hunts monsters using enhanced fighting ability, strength, and the use of magic. The world of The Witcher is a medieval fantasy setting with mages, mythical creatures, but yet it's not really epic fantasy in the Tolkien tradition. It's gritty and dark and has morally ambiguous characters, and there is no chosen one, necessarily, kinda. Given the success of Game of Thrones, which catapulted modern fantasy into the mainstream, The Witcher seemed primed to take over where Game of Thrones left off. So how did they do with this adaptation? Well, let me start with the acting. I thought this was very much one of the highlights of The Witcher. The show stars Henry Cavill of Superman fame in the role of Geralt of Rivia, and also features Anya Charlotra as the mage Yennefer and Freya Allen as Ciri. Henry Cavill does an excellent job with Geralt. He nails the performance, and he's able to show the complexity of Geralt's character with kind of his facial expressions, and he's got little short one-line quips, but he also keeps the loner attitude and cynical view of the world that Geralt kind of has. The real star of the series, in my opinion, though, is Anya Charlotra as Yennefer. I thought she absolutely killed it. This was probably the first thing I think I've ever seen her in, but she gets the opportunity to play Yennefer through a huge arc through the first season, and I thought her character really shined. The acting on the whole was pretty good, and although there was some weaker acting in the side parts, in my opinion, I'd say that on the whole, it was really, really good. I'd give the acting here an 8 out of 10. Now, one part of the acting that I thought made it difficult, in my opinion, was that acting can only be as good as the script. I thought the actors and actresses did a great job of making do with what they had, but I certainly felt like the writing was poor in terms of dialogue, and there were some things with the plot that they were trying to pull off that I felt dragged on due to some clunky writing. I'll talk more about that in a minute. I wouldn't say this was horrible, but I would say there were definitely times it felt like good acting was making up for a weaker script. It just felt like there was like cliche dialogue rather than authentic interactions that real people would have. This was the strength of the first couple seasons of the Game of Thrones, for instance. And so for writing for The Witcher, I'm going to give it a 5 out of 10. Now, as I mentioned, there were some things in the story that the team behind The Witcher tried to pull off with different story threads weaving together and different timelines. And I won't get more into it other than that because I'm trying to keep this spoiler free, but I don't think that this was executed super well. In some television series that try to play with weaving different storylines together or playing with timelines, there's typically a narrative reason for doing so. For instance, in the HBO series Westworld, this is done masterfully, and the reason behind the time jumps become clear later on. In The Witcher, it doesn't really feel like a narrative reason, but more of a necessity because of the source material. In other words, because they're adapting a series of short stories and trying to turn that into an overarching plot, the pacing of the show is just a bit off. Though there are some entertaining moments, I almost stopped watching after the first and second episodes. The pacing isn't consistent throughout the show, and the plot isn't very clear until much later on, and the payoff really wasn't that worth it, in my opinion. Now, all of that being said, by the end of the show, much of it makes sense, and they do a great job of bringing everyone together. It just takes too long for this to happen. I'm going to give The Witcher a 6 out of 10 for pacing. As for the tone and feel of the show, it's certainly its own thing. The Witcher is not trying to be Game of Thrones. It's not trying to be Lord of the Rings. It really is its own thing. It took me a few episodes to appreciate the tone that it was setting for the show, but I really feel like as the season moved on, The Witcher carved out its own identity. This is certainly more fantasy than Game of Thrones in the sense that there's a whole lot of magic, mystical creatures, the setting, the character names. All of that kind of goes into playing into fantasy, but it also has the gore and nudity that you might expect from Game of Thrones. And it lacks that Chosen One arc that typically identifies something as traditional epic fantasy. The Witcher really is its own thing, and that's a good thing. Now, all that being said, will it captivate non-fantasy fans in the same way that Game of Thrones did? I don't think so. Mostly because of the writing and the overall lack of a theme or message behind the story. I'm not saying a show needs a social message, not at all. But I do think that the theme of good versus evil in The Lord of the Rings, or the idea that power corrupts, being a part of that story. Game of Thrones really pushing morally ambiguous characters, and the idea that acting to preserve what's theirs and working to achieve power at all costs is kind of the theme of that story. There are themes to the individual episodes of The Witcher, but nothing that makes you think of it as a work of art, or something that has a message or something to say other than just being an entertaining story of a guy killing monsters. Overall, I think the tone grew on me. I did like that it was individual, and so I'm going to give it a 7 out of 10. In terms of the way the show was shot, I'd say this was hit or miss, but much more of a hit. There were some beautiful camera angles that told the story and expressed emotion from the way the characters were framed. But that was balanced by really choppy editing at times, and in some of the fight scenes specifically, and we'll get to that in a moment. But it also had a very unique way of lighting the various shots. It's really hard for me to describe because I'm certainly not an industry pro when it comes to cinematography, but the way the show was lit and the quality of the backgrounds, it just felt cheaper to me, and I'm not really sure what that was. I can't really put my finger on it, but it didn't have that gritty reality feeling that Game of Thrones had, for instance. I'm sure that someone in the comments can give a better take on this, but something just felt off or different to me, and I'm not smart enough to say what that was, other than that I didn't prefer it. All that being said, though, as I said previously, The Witcher really is its own thing, and there were some very well-shot scenes. And I particularly liked how magic was used and shown most of the time. There are a few exceptions to that, and I'll hit on those here in a minute. But for the most part, the show was really well shot. It just lacked a super authentic feel to me. I'm going to give it a 6 out of 10 for cinematography. Now, the fight choreography in the show was simultaneously amazing in some of the best shots I've ever seen in a fantasy show or movie. And then there was some horrible choreography that falls into the terrible tropes and gimmicky jump cuts and all that. Geralt has some fighting scenes that are jaw-dropping for fantasy show. And they really establish him as the dangerous fighter that he is. There's a fight scene in the first episode in particular that's very well done. And it shows it's a continuous cut that's executed really, really well. There are a couple of these throughout the show that are almost perfect. And then there are some awful fight scenes that just jump cut and don't give us much of the action. It felt like they were just kind of blew through their fighting budget in a couple of those scenes. And then the other ones were just kind of brushed over. The large battle scenes felt really small in scope. And that's largely, I think, reflective of the budget. Rather than the battles having that gritty reality feel of the battle of the bastards from Game of Thrones, it felt more like cheesy trope of seeing large troop movements and then kind of focusing on like four people fighting, and then they stop and talk in the middle of the battle while there's stuff going all around them. Like in reality, they would have been killed the moment they stopped to talk, and that kind of served to essentially make those battles feel a little less realistic to me. It's kind of a trope in fantasy, and I hate it. Now, I'm going to give them a small break here because it's clear that they're capable of doing some really outstanding work. Like I said, most of the fights involving Geralt are outstanding and some of the best I've ever seen in this genre. Most of this is likely budgetary and can be improved upon in future seasons as The Witcher gets a larger budget. I'm going to give The Witcher an 8 out of 10 for fight choreography. Now, to me, set design makes and breaks a fantasy adaptation. I've said that before in other videos. It's never something that you're really going to entirely focus on, but the immersive reality of a fantasy story is based on whether or not you believe, even unconsciously, that you're looking at a place that's lived in and real. Believe it or not, most of the budget in shows like this is set design and making the place feel real and lived in. Shows like Rome on HBO and then obviously Game of Thrones did a great job of fleshing these locations out. I'll go back to Rome, which was really revolutionary at its time. They had this huge budget and they built these entire villas and palaces, and it had a very immersive reality to it in terms of those sets. Much of the budget for the first season of Game of Thrones is in creating the various set locations. And even those were upgraded in later seasons as the show got a higher budget. It was clear here that The Witcher just didn't have a like super massive budget. There were only a few sets that really, really felt lived in and real. Overall, many sets were just outdoor locations with some decorations or a soundstage meant to replicate a town. There were a few well-put-together sets and locations, but on the whole, it just simply wasn't a cohesive set design. And a lot of the dedication to world-building that I believe is necessary to flesh out a massive fantasy show, it just wasn't there. For set design, I'm going to give The Witcher a 5 out of 10. The costumes and makeup were very well done in The Witcher, with only a few notable exceptions. Let's first talk about the good ones. Yennefer has a transformation in the show, and that's as far as I'm going to go without getting into spoiler territory. But her physical transformation was pretty astounding. The makeup and costume design for her alone was, and some of the prosthetics that she wears are executed extremely well. It made it very believable. Geralt looks exactly as he should look, and his costume is great. In fact, I think Henry Cavill was meant to play him. In fact, most of the makeup was really well done, as well as the costumes. The only really bad things in this category were the army uniforms for a certain set of bad guys. They legit look, and I'm not joking, they legit look like shriveled balls in a penis hat. I'll let you guys rewatch it and see what I'm talking about. But it was really poorly done. I hated those uniforms. And then there was one really poorly done mythical creature in an early episode. Again, I won't get into spoilers here, but I thought it looked pretty awful. Outside of those two things, I thought this was done really well. I'm going to give costume and makeup a 7 out of 10. Now, the special effects in the show are mixed in my opinion as well. But again, this is more than likely the result of a low budget than a lack of skill. Fantasy stories are special effects driven, and The Witcher has quite a few creatures that require CGI and the use of magic that requires CGI and all that. So for the most part, I would say it was done fairly well. The magic is done pretty tastefully, which I thought was a good thing. Sometimes in fantasy stories, magic can turn into wizards shooting lasers out of their hands, and they didn't do that here. There's a theme to the magic. It was consistent, and the special effects were pretty decent in that regard. Some of the creatures look good, but you can also tell that they're completely CGI, and it kind of takes away from the immersiveness of the show. I would say with a bigger budget, they could do some really great work here. It just doesn't seem like it's there yet. Special effects got a 6 out of 10 for me. And then lastly, the music of a show can really make it or break it, as I said in my last video about the composer for The Wheel of Time. The music of The Witcher, on the whole, was really good. There are unique themes for the show that are authentic to the games, and they have their own style. I was not overly impressed with the score at the beginning of the show. I'm not sure why. But as it went on, I felt the style of the music. It kind of grew on me. It's definitely different than most of the other shows I've listened to. They're using different instruments and things like that. But I really thought it corresponded to the tone of the show. I would say the music at the end, like as I got done watching it, I really liked the music. The other thing that I'm going to add about music here is the Toss the Coin to Your Witcher song that the bard sings, portrayed by Joey Beatty. He sings it in the show, and it is incredibly catchy, and I can't get it out of my head. This was really well done, and I think it'll be remembered about the show later on. I've actually listened to the song on YouTube like 10 times now, just out of the blue. I'll have that link in the description below, but that was really well done. So overall, I liked the music for the show, and while I wouldn't say it's like groundbreaking or spectacular, kind of like Game of Thrones music was really, really good, I would say this is still good. I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10. In summary, I feel like the show started very slow and it ended very well. I do think this show was written to be binged. What I mean by that is it's kind of best to be watched all at once or as quickly as you can. I don't think it would do as well if it was dropped weekly. And I would challenge you that if you're only a few episodes in and you're not really sure if you're liking it, push through. It gets a lot better, especially around episodes 4 through 8. I can generally say that I was entertained, and I'm very much looking forward to season 2. Despite season 1 kind of getting a mixed review from me, I'm excited to see where they take the story from here. And I would say this was a pretty good fantasy adaptation. It's not groundbreaking. It's not going to change the genre or become a phenomenon like Game of Thrones did. But it will stand on its own as a new franchise. And I think Netflix did a decent job with this. And I'm certainly going to keep watching. In total, The Witcher series gets a 6.6 out of 10 from me. But maybe what you all want to know, and what I'm probably the most excited to talk about anyway, is what The Wheel of Time can learn from The Witcher adaptation. I do think there are a couple major things that The Witcher did well that The Wheel of Time would do well to adopt. One is the use of multiple plot lines and having multiple main characters to follow. This was not always done super well in The Witcher, but following multiple storylines at once is engaging, and it gives us different people to cheer for. It also kind of splits the story up so we don't get bored on one plotline. This is absolutely going to be necessary for The Wheel of Time. Now, obviously in later books with The Wheel of Time, this isn't an issue, as Robert Jordan wrote the books with tons of different plotlines going on simultaneously. But early on, we only get a select group of characters to follow in The Wheel of Time. Rafe Judkins, The Wheel of Time showrunner, would do well to give us some other plot lines to follow at the beginning. And all signs point to the production team actually doing this, because it looks like there will be an expanded role for Loghain Eblor. In terms of some negatives I'd like to see The Wheel of Time avoid, I'll first say that these are two entirely different stories. So before I get into that, let's understand that these things are not apples to apples. The worlds are set differently, the plots are incredibly different, and the characters are more numerous in The Wheel of Time. Everything is bigger in scale in The Wheel of Time, but the story is much more linear and easier to follow. One of the things that was a struggle to understand in The Witcher was the plot lines jumping around and kind of the timing of things. Wheel of Time really shouldn't struggle with this, as the story is mostly linear and it's complete. I think The Witcher has a higher barrier to entry than The Wheel of Time should, because The Witcher story assumes that the Watcher knows a bit about The Witcher and the nature of the magic, or that they played the games or read the books. Show don't tell is really important, but the context in The Witcher is hard to figure out what's going on at first. Hopefully The Wheel of Time will be easier to get a non-book reader to watch it. A weakness of The Witcher that I'd like to see The Wheel of Time improve upon is a hook at the end of an episode. There was very little at the end of The Witcher episodes that kind of captivated me and had me desperately wanting to watch another episode. There just wasn't enough tension at times. I'd like to see The Wheel of Time kind of hook viewers with compelling endings to each of the episodes. This also ties into my desire to see The Wheel of Time released weekly rather than dumping all the episodes at once. There's just less to talk about with The Witcher and debate as there would be if we had to wait each week for each episode. This is evident with the success of The Mandalorian on Disney Plus, which I may do another episode like this if you guys enjoy this review, because I do think there's a lot that could be learned from even The Mandalorian. The last thing I'd like to see The Wheel of Time learn from The Witcher is that new viewers need to be hooked early. The Witcher plays out like a slow burn to me, and I didn't particularly get invested in the characters until Yennefer's introduction, and that even took a few episodes to really kind of understand what was going on there. I'm hoping that the superior story of The Wheel of Time will be more compelling and will help us care about the characters more from the beginning. If you've seen The Witcher, tell me what you think. What do you think The Wheel of Time can learn from The Witcher TV show? Please let me know in the comments below. And as I promised, I want to give you guys a quick sneak peek to the upcoming Wheel of Time community website. Again, I apologize for all this going on here. I'm still randomly sick, so if I look like I'm crying, I just get emotional talking about this stuff. Hey, but let's start by unveiling the name. We did quite a bit of deliberating here, and we arrived at a name that I think demonstrates the very dark origins of this channel, given that I am the Nameless. We are deep in the shadow here. The URL for the website is going to be www.thegreatblight.com. You can actually go to that link right now. It is active, but all you're going to get is a coming soon page there, so deal with that. But so that's kind of exciting, though, and you'll get to see some stuff rebranded around the channel towards The Great Blight as well, and some new merch. In terms of the website itself, it's going to be a community depository for some news updates, other content creators, information about The Wheel of Time, a completely updated wiki with new visuals, new maps. The goal is a one-stop shop for the Wheel of Time fandom. What I'm showing you here on screen is one of the entries for the wiki that we've been creating. This is the page for Moraine. Obviously, don't read too much if you don't want to be spoiled, but it's set up that you won't be spoiled too much. Obviously, a lot of this can change the further that the site goes towards construction, but I wanted to show you guys a bit of this page. It's set up where there are links to media about Moraine, so you can see a video there, as well as entries that are set up to avoid spoilers. For instance, if you're only on book two, you can read the entries up to that point and stop before you get to spoilers. So that's kind of cool that it's set up that way. There's going to be a much more detailed video going up on the Patreon here soon that will show some more of the work behind the scenes and better explain some of the functionality as we get closer to a launch. I want to thank those of you that are volunteering to write out a lot of this information and helping with the creation of the site. And I'd also love to thank all of you that are already patrons of the channel. Without your support, we wouldn't be able to make this possible. We wouldn't be able to keep the community growing around The Wheel of Time. Please consider supporting the channel either on Patreon or by picking up a free audiobook on Audible or picking up a couple months of free Skillshare service. You can see those links below. All of that greatly supports and helps the channel. Also, this one's free. join the Discord server and talk with us about the Wheel of Time. There's a huge community we have going there. If you don't know about Discord, it's simple. Click the link. It'll explain itself. But it's just a place where we can all talk about it. That link is in the description below as well. Make sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel to be updated when I post new Wheel of Time content. Pretty much everything I do here is associated with the Wheel of Time, so if you like that, hit the subscribe button. Hey guys, thanks again for watching, and until next time, peace out.
Tinker in the kitchen with a job of work to do. Mistress up above, slipping on a rope of blue. She prances down the staircase, a fancy oh so free, crying, Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me?